Yeah, I'm Philipp. I work as a developer advocate for Couchbase, actually based out of London. And today we're going to talk a little bit like how you would develop, an API, a JSON API backed by Couchbase and backed by Node.js to develop a really simple game. And to do this, let me just introduce it. This is what this talk is basically about. So we're gonna check out how we can have like, okay, this is a simple quiz game, which automatically updates and all that stuff, but it's a game, so we need some users, so we're gonna learn how we're gonna deal with user authentication in Couchbase. We gonna figure out how we can actually deal with game state, so how can we save game state in a performant way and deal with it easy server side. And finally, we're gonna look at how we can deal with actually showing aggregates. So something like this, there is a count in there. If you can't read it, it actually says 3. So it's actually just a count. We want to display a count, like how many people answered this question in this way. So this is mainly the 3 parts I'm gonna talk about and how that would be implemented in a, performant way. So what we wanna do is we want to build an API using Couchbase and then display it in a web application. So for an API, what we need to consider is a couple different things. So first of all, we have to consider, okay, we want it to be responsive. And by responsive, I don't mean the responsive in the web kind of way with I can resize my browser to whatever size. I'm actually talking about like, okay, I want to have a really fast response time. I want to be able to respond in a couple milliseconds without much trouble. I want it to be efficient because especially if in the web application world, most often we have the problem that we might not have a lot of users, but suddenly we might have a lot of users and we have to deal with that. And we don't want to, just because we get a million users, we don't have to need to spend hundreds of thousands on servers. So we want it to be efficient in that kind of sense of resources. And we want it to be scalable because if you actually think about it, most of the time you're gonna have users coming on and it's really hard to figure out in advance what's going to happen, when are the users coming and how many are gonna come. So you need to pretty dynamically scale that up and down. I used to work for a company, and we developed a backend for a media, it was a TV show in Germany, and it was on for 2 hours a week. So, and during those 2 hours, we had a lot of traffic. Otherwise, we almost didn't have any traffic, obviously. So we needed to like scale up, deal with the traffic, and then also scale down later because we don't want to waste a lot of resources just to keep servers running. Okay, so for this talk, I used to do a lot of JavaScript, and I still do a lot of JavaScript. So let's select some technologies based on a couple facts out of actually the JavaScript world. So we want to have high concurrency because, we hopefully gonna have a lot of users in the future. To deal with the scalability nicely, we most likely want to have a shared nothing architecture, or share almost nothing, let's say like this. So we can easily rack up more nodes, more servers as the need arises and can deal with it there. And especially for me, I want my technology to be fun to use. I don't want it to be like, oh, I need to architect a lot of stuff, but I actually want to like get in there and build stuff. So what kind of technologies do we have there? I wanted to use JavaScript everywhere, so the obvious choice for the backend is then Node.js. There are a couple more server-side JavaScript implementations, but I think Node.js is actually probably the most common and, it has been around for some time now and has been selected by multiple companies as well, so it is a good technology. For the web interface, probably the quickest to get started with and get going is actually AngularJS, and it fits really nicely in the Node.js stack to start out with. It's backed by Google, so that's a good thing. And yeah, so to finish up the full stack of the JavaScript, of course, we are at the Couchbase conference, so we're gonna select Couchbase as the database. And because we can actually pretty much do everything we want with JavaScript there. And it has support for JSON, so that's a good thing as well. We can directly deal with JSON in the database. In JavaScript, it's the easiest thing to deal with anyway. And finally, in the browser, it's pretty good as well. Okay, so the thing is, Node.js, it's really not just this hip thing anymore. There are actually a lot of companies who have selected it as their backend language now. Like PayPal wrote a lot about it, Walmart wrote a lot about it. So actually a lot of major companies adopted it. So it's not just this, let's use something really fancy, but it's actually used in the wild quite often. And also, it has a great support for this event-driven model, which is actually comes quite naturally to a web application. So you have a request coming in, which is kind of an event coming to you. You deal with that, and you go back to your users. It's share nothing by default. If you look at the frameworks, how they are architected, most likely they are like, okay, I have this server, and it doesn't have like any close relationship to anything around it, so that's good. And V8 is actually a pretty fast, so V8 is the JavaScript engine behind Node.js. It's actually a pretty fast runtime. It might not be as fast as a JVM, but it actually is really well optimized by now to deal with a lot of problems. AngularJS and for the browser, well, yeah, it brings most of the best practices from JavaScript, like, okay, model view, whatever, I think is the thing they actually say. It can use data binding, so you just write a little enhanced HTML which deals with all your rendering then, which is really nice to use and which works really nicely. We have MVC in the browser, like I said, and it's very convenient because you have the data binding, so you just say, okay, this field should be displayed here, and it takes care of keeping that in sync. That's good. Okay, Couchbase, it's a good fit for Node.js because, well, it can store JSON, and we deal with JSON in JavaScript already, good. We can use JavaScript as our query language for the views, so we are writing JavaScript already, writing more JavaScript, that's good. And it's really designed to scale, so it fits the architecture of having a lot of Node.js nodes backed by a varying amount of Couchbase nodes. That fits really nicely. So let's just look at how that really works and how that looks like, especially with the new SDK. So in the new SDK, we I don't know if you've been to any of the other sessions introducing it, but we now have this abstraction over, okay, we have this cluster, which is our Couchbase cluster, and from there we can actually open buckets and do stuff. So what does it look like? Okay, if we want to store something, we're going to have this JSON document. Really nicely, we can just write JSON as we would write in JavaScript anyway. We can insert or upsert it into a bucket. So upsert is update or insert. So just put it in there. I don't care what happened before. We store it under the key. We can get it back out, and we can disconnect. So let's just see how that actually looks if it runs. So normally I'd do this as a live coding, but since I didn't know if I could use, since I didn't want to screw up, I decided, okay, let's pre-record this. So this is what we get. We can, we store something, we get it back out, and what we get is the value we just stored, which is good, and we also get this CAS value. And I don't know if you've, know about the concept we have for the CAS already, but it is this value which gives us the opportunity to do optimistic locking, and we're gonna go into this a little later. So let me just step through. So first of all, okay, we're gonna require Couchbase, we're gonna connect to the cluster, we're gonna open a bucket. This point, okay, we actually have a connection to do stuff. So what do we need there? So the cluster abstracts away the cluster. It knows like what nodes to connect to, what nodes are there, how to deal with the connection. it abstracts away the complete like reconnecting. So Couchbase has a smart client architecture. So once you connect, it pulls down all the information it has about the cluster, and it now can like, oh, if the connection goes down, it automatically reconnects to the node. So you can just grab a connection once and then use it all over the place. It also multiplexes all the data on the connection, and it actually keeps open as many connections as you need in the background, and that's completely managed by our code, so you don't have to deal with that, which is really nice. So if you think about it, if you do deal, for example, with other database, you would have to like, okay, I have this connection pool, and I select the connections I want to use. You don't really have to do this. Just open one, and in the background, it will actually do that for you. And it handles all the updates from the cluster. So if a node goes down, it will be notified. Your client will automatically be notified about it, and it will update the internal representation of the cluster, so you can move. You can just keep on using the connection without any real interruption. So okay, and so this means actually connecting and then using that connection. Well, the initial connection is somewhat heavyweight because we connect, we grab all this information about the cluster, we build up state inside our cluster to be as efficient as possible. So you should probably reuse this connection. So in Node.js, you would probably write something like this, and this actually comes from a project I have. Just like, okay, just save off your connection and give it back every time you need one. Just don't like accidentally reestablish a connection every time. So yeah, okay. So let's go into the details on how we can actually write the code. Okay, so first we want to manage users. So what does it mean? Manage users, we need to create new users when they sign up, maybe through, well, username, password, through Facebook, through whatever. We need to manage the sign-in for the user because, well, if they come back, they obviously want to reuse the stuff they already did, so we need to sign them in and we need to authenticate them. Basically, with every request, we don't want to hold a lot of state. Okay, so sign up. If you're familiar with Node.js, that will most likely look familiar. What we have is we have our app, and we define a route to post, to do a HTTP post to the sign up route, and that gets passed the request and where we should put the result. And we can grab the credentials the user passed. So if you actually use this, so we want to have the front end give us, okay, this is the username he wants, this is the password he wants, so we can deal with it. And then we just go into our user and create our user with those credentials. And we're gonna see this shortly how that actually looks. And okay, then we go like, okay, if that worked, good, we can just redirect him to our game. If that didn't work, and obviously save his user ID in the session, so he doesn't have to like sign in again immediately. Otherwise, we can show an error message. So how does that user create, which is actually kind of the meat of the stuff? So okay, we're gonna get some credentials, we're gonna create a new user object, check if it's valid. So valid in this case, we mean, okay, does he have a valid username according to whatever rules we have, and does he have a valid password and so forth. So maybe we want to enforce some password rules. And then we actually save this user, and it's common in Node.js that you use everything async, so you're gonna pass a callback, which is called whenever the user saving is actually done. And if there are errors, we're gonna, return some errors to the users. You can actually deal with that on the page. Good. So what does saving look like? So this is now actually the Couchbase code. So what do we have here? We have the, first of all, you never want to save passwords as the real password. So in this case, I decide, okay, bcrypt, it's a nice library, it encrypts the password and we can later use it really simply. So okay, I think just use it whenever you want to deal with passwords. But the important thing really is that we now do a db add, or in the new SDK, you could also use db insert. And that will actually make sure that the key you're gonna give the user will only ever be used once. So it will actually throw you an error in case the user, the key has already been used. Since our key is our user ID or our username, we can make sure, okay, this username is not, has not been taken before, which is nice. Well, then we just stringify our user and okay, it's safe. That should be incredibly quick because the operations are quick. Good. So now how can we deal with sign-in? Now we have the user in there and we need to actually authenticate him. So when he signs in, we just, again, he should pass, obviously, his username and password. We authenticate him, and we have this on our user model, and this should return us the authenticated user. It should return, okay, this is the user with all the details we need about him, and we can store him away to use later. Cool, so we just have this user authenticate. So how does it look like? Actually, internally, it like just forwards to check password in this case. Okay, check password. It just gets the password we have, he gave us, and what the password was that that was loaded from the database. And we compare those two. That's bcrypt, nice. We're done. If that works, cool. So the same, actually, if we want to use that as a middleware, which is a concept in Express, what I use there, you could just wrap around this, and every time a user comes, we're gonna validate his ID. So we already saved this ID to the session, so we just check, okay, this, it should be there, that's good, let's validate it. So now we can actually use the power of having Couchbase have incredibly fast loads. So we can, the validate look is kind of simple. We just create a new user with this ID, and we try to load it from the database. So this means we can, it's just gonna do a get. It's just gonna take like the user ID and it's just gonna try to fetch it. And if that works, great, we have authenticated the user. So in this case, we really take advantage of having those incredibly fast gets where we don't need to like have a cache in front of that as well if we normally have with, if you use something like MySQL, but we can actually just hit the database and use it. So for this, we need to obviously make sure that we have a good key for our users. So our get can actually just operate on a key. We don't need to like query a view or something which would be slower. It would still be fast, but it would be slower. We actually want to be as fast as possible. So for this, we're gonna use a predictable key. In this case, the username. Another common thing we're gonna do is we're actually gonna prefix it because, well, there might be a lot of different stuff stored in the bucket we just, well, where we stored the user. A common thing is to create like one bucket per application maybe. And so they're gonna be, okay, they're gonna be our game state later stored in there, there's gonna be our users stored in there. So, okay, we want to prefix it so we don't have some key clashes for some weird reason. So in this case, I just decide, okay, I'm gonna use u colon colon for user. And gonna have the username. That it's really nice because it's a fixed prefix, so we know like, okay, if we get a username, if I just prefix it, I can just get that. That's good. And if I later want to add more stuff like, okay, maybe he wants to sign in via his Facebook ID, maybe he wants to sign in via his email address, we can just create referential keys to his main document. So his main document is gonna be keyed by his user ID. If he signs in with that, great. If he wants to sign in via his email address, well, we just create a key for user and then his email address, which just points to, oh, no, actually what you want to load is this one. So you have like one level of indirection to deal with here. But that makes user authentication actually really nice and really quick. Good. So at this stage, we come to the more interesting part, which is actually managing our game state. So game state is like, what do we need to do there? We have the game, we have some answers, we just display it on the page, so we have, in this case, I used a fixed list, but there could be a dynamic list which is loaded from the database, where we have questions and answers in, we're gonna display, and so we need to save the answers the user has given us, and we need to load them when he refreshes the page or when he comes back after some time. So how does that work? Okay, so we wanted to build a JSON API. So, okay, we're gonna define one easy route, which is, okay, questions, we make sure the user's authenticated. We have that now, that's good. And we're going to serve JSON all the way, because our web interface is going to deal with it via AngularJS. OK, so what we can do now is we're just going to load the, I named it question list for the user. We have the user already in the request because we authenticated him, and it was so quick to load the whole user, so we just did. And OK, if we don't have that, or if our server has died, well, malfunctioned, then we return 500. But what we're actually interested in is, okay, we load this list and we send it back as JSON, and that should have anything in there, basically an aggregate of everything we want to display, so it's just one thing. Okay, so how do we do that? And again, we come back to creating a good key so we can load it really quickly. We take, okay, we're gonna prefix it with question list, so QL, and then we're just going to use key it by the user ID. So every time we have a user, we can just really easily do one get and load all his questions and all his game state, whatever that may be, actually. And yeah, so that's exactly that. So we store the state for the user. We're going to store him as user Phil. And for questions, we're going to store a question list for him, and assuming that he only has one question list. Otherwise, we could maybe attach a counter or something in the end as well. And this makes it possible to easily, like, we don't store it inside the user, because maybe we want to use this, our users, for something else later. Having this like reference where we easily know how to find the stuff, like the question in this case, means that we can lazily load it when we need it. We don't like load it every time we load the user, we load a huge document, but we actually know, okay, this for the users, we load this. If we need the questions, okay, load it here. And now, of course, we also need to save it. That is pretty much the same as for the user again. So, okay, have our questions, gonna be passed some JSON by our AngularJS application, and we save it for our user. Sorry, does that look, and in the end, we actually load the new state. Maybe something has changed in between, especially like our answer count might have changed or will have changed, most likely. Okay, so the nice thing is that Couchbase, like I said, it can already deal with JSON really nicely already. So we can just do a DB set or upsert or how it would be named in the new SDK. There is this, we now have, currently have this two options, but moving forward, it should probably be update or upsert. So we already created a key where we can find it easily. We just put it in there. And we also pass along this CAS value, and we're going to talk about this shortly, because what do we have right now? We have the problem, like in today's world, let's say, we have loads of different devices. Actually, in this case, it's just Apple devices, but they might access it via their iPhone, via their Android phone, via your laptop and everything. So the problem there is that you might actually end up in the situation where you don't want to like accidentally override information a user just given. You need some kind of way to figure out, okay, what is the, has somebody like changed my document underneath from between the time I loaded it, changed it and want to save it back, and somebody else did the same thing, maybe from another device. In our case, it might be the same user being like on his laptop and on his phone. So how does the CAS work? It is basically, we have our two actors. They both load our document. And let's say actor one saves the document first. So he passes the document and this CAS value, which is basically identifying the current state. And he's going to save, and that's going to succeed, because there hasn't been any changes underneath in between. But for the second actor, when he tries to save, we can return an error and say, like, oh, sorry, it has changed in between. How do you want to deal with this? And dealing with this, you actually then have to do in your application code because, well, we don't know how you might want to merge your data, for example, or maybe you want to throw away other changes. So you actually have to like write some code to actually deal with that. Most likely, in something like this, you just want to like say, okay, don't access my application from multiple ways. I don't know how you want to, might not know how I can merge that, but I can make sure I don't accidentally throw away information. So, okay, how does it look in real code? So we need to actually get the CAS value before we can save it, obviously. So, okay, we have this, okay, we're gonna get the question lists. So we could do db.get or db.get, and we get the key and it loads. If it doesn't find it, we return default, that's all good. But actually the interesting part is, with the data we're gonna get passed back by our database, we've seen in the beginning that we also get this CAS value. So we're just gonna store this away for now in our, in this case, our question list. So we can actually, if we need to pass it along later, we have it. And so we need to then, if we store it, we've already seen that we just pass it back and we still have the CAS value. So this is it's optimistic locking. The good thing is that since Couchbase is really fast on the requests, the potential for actually having conflicts between the, okay, I loaded the list, I changed it in some way and saved it back, if that all happens server-side, the potential time where somebody can interfere with that is really small, unless your application takes a long processing time. But actually, the operational and Couchbase itself are really fast, so the potential that there is conflict and that you have to deal with it is quite low. You still have to deal with it, but you're not going to end up in a loop where you're like, okay, I fetched the value. I change it, I try to save it back. Oh, somebody changed it. I fetch it again, change it again, try to save it back. Oh, somebody did it in between. It's highly unlikely because the operations are just so quick. The nice thing about this optimistic locking is that the overhead on the database is quite low because all it has to do is it has to pass you this CAS value, which basically just reflects like what is the state right now. If you've seen in the beginning, it was this weird object, but what it actually is, it's just a 64-bit value. It doesn't have any real meaning besides like this is what the state is right now. So with this, we can actually go to the front end. So we were saying, okay, AngularJS, it has a nice few templates, and we're gonna see this shortly. We can encapsulate our logic, and this is actually from the web page. So it has model view, whatever works. Not just whatever works, which I really like as a concept. And the templates are basically just enhanced HTML. So in the beginning I thought like, okay, how big is that gonna be if I now write this? Okay, I serve JSON, that's good. But how big of an application do I end up with? That's all of it. So that's why I'm not gonna tell you more about AngularJS in this case, because it really just does, okay, let's fetch the data and then check if anything ever changes. If it changes, send it back to the server. That might not be the best optimized implementation, but it works. It actually works, and it's just, well, probably like 20 lines of code. To get started with that was really nice. So how does it work? Yeah, well, we create a controller in the model view controller sense. We load the data, and then we actually watch on this object we just loaded, and if something changes, we can just post it back to our questions as this stringified value. Cool. And the templates, just to give you a different idea how they look like, it's actually all you need to do is you need to add those certain properties like ng controller. This is actually controlled by this controller. And you display via this, okay, for each question in question, render some stuff, and there we render it out. So that's actually really simple and really nice. If you want to see the code, it's all on GitHub, and there are some more details in there, but this is the, like, from the top level what it looks like. So, and now we actually come to the last piece, which is really interesting, is how can we actually display this answer count we had in the beginning? So for this, we're gonna use views, and views have gotten a lot better in 3.0. So there were, I talked to one of the guys who was in Germany actually developing on the view engine, and he told me, well, there are actually a lot of improvements in there around speed, around, well, how consistent the data is, because they actually now come, before, I don't know if you know, but before they came from whenever the item was actually stored to disk, the indexer picked it up and then indexed it. What now happens, actually the data gets streamed from memory towards the view engine. The view engine executes its JavaScript and creates the index. So it's like way quicker and it better hooks into the whole system. So one important thing, stale false now actually means you're not gonna get stale data from the time of, okay, there is this request, and at the time it hit the server, we're gonna update the index to its current state and return you the data. So there's no this lag in between, like, okay, if it has been saved to disk, then it's, yeah. So there is a lot less lag, which is nice. So just to give you an overview how this really looks, okay, so we have a lot of different things in our database, for example, this bar and some other things as well. So if we now want to create a view, we're just gonna create a view named bars in this example. And for this, we're actually gonna create a count view. And actually the one which works for our question list is quite similar because we actually want to aggregate as well. So for our view, what we're gonna use is something like, okay, figure out, okay, is it a question list? That's good. For the question list, we're gonna sum up for answer A, this is the count. For answer B, this, or actually not sum up, but actually count how many people answered yes, how many people answered no, and so forth. So it actually looks quite similar, but I wanted to have it in a little smaller, smaller thing. So, okay, so we figured out, okay, those are bars, and now we can just create a count, and the count gives us, okay, actually, there are two bars in our database, and if we now want to split it up by its IDs, we could group it together, and this is actually what I do as well. So we split apart by user and his question list, and then we actually get the counts for each question in this case. Cool. So how does it work? If we want to see it in code, we get our connection, we create a view by its, this is what I called my view, and counts, NCQA for node couch question game, well, anyway. And actually use stale false because I want to make sure, okay, I don't want to have stale counts in this case. And I have this choices keys, which are just the keys like, okay, question 1A, 1B, 1C, and so forth, want to display. Okay, and then I just query the server, get the results, and I can enhance my JSON, which I loaded before, with like, okay, for this key, there are for question 1A, there are so many answers. For question 1B, there are so many, and so forth. Good. So, at this stage, we actually have our complete little project, and if you want to see it, like I said, it's all in GitHub. You can find it under Couchbase Labs, like many, many more sample projects. And if you have any questions, just visit, like, we try to be as active as possible on the communities, and we try to answer as many questions. So if you have not stopped by the communities lately, do so. Actually, for this whole thing, we've written that up, and actually a colleague of mine, Brett Lawson, has written it up in a blog post, so we'll find much more detail in there on how you would actually create that. And yeah, check out the new SDK version for Node, because it changed somewhat, and it made it actually a lot nicer, like the whole cluster management, having that encapsulated in an object is really nice, and not having like this per bucket connect more, having more connections, more grouped by cluster and not just by bucket. Okay, and I think I'm actually, yeah, I'm pretty much good on time. So if you have any questions, just ask away. Yeah?
Does this work for promises instead of callbacks in the UK?
The SDK is actually based on callbacks, but you could easily, you could pretty easily like do something like queue to just promissify it. It works pretty good. Well, the thing is that underneath the SDK, it uses the libcouchbase, and libcouchbase already uses callback style for its management, so it's just passed through. So it's the simplest layer above, that's why they are. Yeah. And I guess there is enough discussion around callbacks and promises in the Node world already. Yeah. Yes? There is actually one by Couchbase itself. It's still in the Couchbase labs. If you look for it, it's called Ottoman, which is an ODM on top of Couchbase. Tried out. We're still like figuring out how it exactly gonna end up with. There, I don't think there is any from like common providers, I don't think there is one. At least I don't know. But we provide our own, which you could hook in if you wanted to.
Do you think, is that because in Couchbase, is it the model that everything's just completely denormalized and you're not doing joins and complex structures? It just everything is so undocumented, in which case you don't need it because you're just reading and writing JSON?
Yeah, most of the time you're actually just reading and writing JSON, so there is not the need so much. I still think it is useful to have, for example, just to hook in more stuff like validations and all that stuff. So it's nice to have, but the thing is that a lot of the operations you do are, like you said, they are just key value and not so much like updating internal stuff or querying on internal stuff, because if you query on like really deep nested parts, you then need to create views, and they are by nature slower than if you do a lot more key value queries. So the really common thing, like data modeling wise, is just use more key value queries than like one quite complicated view query. And I think that's one of the reasons why there aren't not so much established ODMs for Couchbase. Yeah. Yes. Sorry, what? Sorry, it's quite hard to understand. Could you?
I'm just asking you to do the
C++. Yeah.
So do you have
any
concerns?
Oh. Yeah. Well, the thing is that actually, if you look at the Couchbase SDK, most of it is actually implemented on top of libcouchbase, which has, so it calls out to a C library, which has, well, which manages its own threads and everything. So yes, Node.js is single threaded, but as soon as you pass off the handling to libcouchbase, you're gonna be in a different, well, you're gonna be using different, thread pool kind of anyway. So there is not there's not so much of a problem with having like long running operations blocking your main thread in libcouchbase and, well, in the whole Node.js SDK. That answers your question.
So does that mean that it uses all the ports available in the server even though Node.js is only using one?
It could be using all your cores in the server if you have so many operations, yes. So libcouchbase itself, I mean, libcouchbase is again like an event-driven library, so I'm not exactly sure how many threads they spawn and if they do that, but it actually uses it uses multiple cores, yes. So.
But that happens internally, right? It's not something that you have.
You don't have to care about that. That's what I meant by like we have this smart client which abstracts that away from you. So. If you want to, I mean, the code is all open source on GitHub, so you could just look at how many, like, how that actually works internally. But personally, I didn't have any problems with it, and it actually doesn't block the run loop or anything really badly. Yeah?
Is there some cloud environment where we can try out this entire stuff without installing anything?
There are, like, for example, Amazon EC2 machines where you could spin one up and try it out. They are on this, there's this AWS marketplace, for example. Also, with, there is a provider, what's it, Couchbase, and they have Heroku, well, they have plugins for Heroku, so you could run it on Heroku, for example, which is a cloud provider. But well, you, most likely, if you want to develop locally, you would have to at least install Node.js, because, well, yeah. Yes. Yeah, so the new 2.0 SDK has support for Nickel. It's not as, I don't think, well, Nickel is still developer preview, so it's in there, but it's not like, it's not gonna be supported by us until it's out of developer preview, obviously. But yeah, there is like basic support for it, it's in there. You can pass a query string and it's gonna return you the result. Yeah. Yeah. Not directly from Couchbase Server. What you could just do is use Sync Gateway for that.
Okay. So the tap feed, for example, isn't exposed in the
No. I think like I don't know if you've been in the other, but we are now developing this new like DCP protocol, which is going to be exposed sometime in the future, but it's just not exposed yet. Yeah, I mean, it greatly depends on your data model, I would say. Like, what that would be one way. I mean, I recently did one thing where, like, I try to make sure that my referential keys are in order. That's, like, a really good thing which you can do with a view. So you can, like, make a view which gives you a list of everything you need to deal with and then iterate over its result every now and then. If that's something like a batch process. Otherwise, yeah, maybe hook into Sync Gateway's changes feed, or yeah, that would probably be the thing right now, I would say. Yeah, so I think I'm out of time. So thank you all for being here, and yeah.